Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of 2017 of the Equality and Human Rights Committee. Can I make the usual request that mobile phones and digital devices are switched on to flight mode or silent, please? We've received no apologies for this meeting this morning, so we'll continue as planned. Agenda item one is a decision on taking agenda items four and five in private. Are committee content to do so?
Agreed. Agreed.
Thank you so much. Agenda item two is a piece of subordinate legislation this morning. The civil partnership marriage between persons of different sexes and same-sex marriage prescribed bodies Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016. Members have a paper in front of them from the clerks setting out the purpose of the statutory instrument and to make you aware that the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee did not have any comments to make on this instrument. Members have any comments to make? No comment to make on the statutory instrument? So, okay. Noted. Thank you very much. So, agenda item three is a substantive agenda item this morning, which is a focus on the Scottish Human Rights Commission's annual report and the third strategic plan. And I'm delighted to welcome with us this morning in this formal capacity, because it's your first opportunity to do this as an organisation, although we've heard from you many, many times on many subjects. But we're delighted to have the Scottish Human Rights Commission with us this morning. And with us we have the Chair of the Commission, Judith Robertson, the Head of Strategy and Legal, Kavita Chetty, and the Business Manager at the Commission, Claire Nicholson. Now, you all have a copy of the strategic plan and the report in your papers, but I'm going to ask Judith if she would give us an opening statement to give us an insight into your report and your forward plan. Judith.
Great. Okay, thank you very much. I thought I would take the opportunity, as it is the first time we've been here, just to say a few words about the establishment of the Commission, what its overall role is, and then we can come to the details of the strategic plan and the annual report in the course of the session, if that's okay. And just so that it's on the record, we are Scotland's national human rights institution. We are established in 2008 under the legislation that went through the Parliament. We are effectively a body of the UN, part of a global network of national human rights institutions, which are encouraged by the UN for states to support organisations like our own to support the domestic protection and promotion of human rights. This means we're considered to be a bridge between the international framework of human rights laws and their implementation domestically in Scotland. We're also tasked to be a bridge between government, Parliament and civil society, and to highlight and bring attention to human rights issues within the country. We're assessed against Paris principles, which accredit us based on meeting principles of independence, plurality and breadth of our mandate. We are an A-status organisation within the UN accreditation system, which means we have speaking rights at the UN Human Rights Council. That's an important aspect because it means we can independently comment and have comment on the record of the Scottish Government in that context. And as you will know, I'm sure, our legislation provides a general duty to promote awareness, understanding and respect for human rights, and in particular to promote best practice in relation to human rights. It comes with certain powers to publish advice, guidance and ideas, to conduct research and provide education and training. And the Commission may also review and recommend changes to law, policy and practice. We also have additional legal powers to conduct inquiries and to intervene in civil proceedings before a court in certain circumstances. So that's the kind of broad context in which the Commission is operating. We are one of, as I say, over 100 NHRIs established around the world. We are one of three NHRIs operating in the UK. That's the Northern Ireland Human Rights Institution and the Equality and Human Rights Institution. And we share our mandate in different ways, which I can talk about in detail if you're interested in that. So we have that status. We value that status clearly. We were established as an A-status institution when we originally started, and that was reaffirmed in 2015. And every 5 years, we submit that process. So it's an important part of our perspective as an organisation and something that we work to maintain. rather than go into the detail of the strategic plan, I thought I would open up, leave that at the moment, and then give you opportunities just to ask us questions, which we will attempt to answer.
Thanks very much, Judith. Some of the members have got some specific areas that they want to explore in your report, and I'm going to go first to Mary.
Convener, and good morning to you. I wanted to ask you about the commitment that you make to mental health. When you talk about working with the Scottish Government's Implementation Group for Mental Health, using the opportunity to support a rights-based approach to implementing the Act. People that suffer from mental health, there are a huge range of difficulties and problems. And I just wonder if you could explain a bit more in practical terms on how you see that work progressing.
The work that the Commission is doing,
yes,
in relation to mental health. So we have, as you may be aware, made a submission to the consultation in relation to the mental health strategy and the development of the mental health strategy. That submission was really calling on the government to take a rights-based approach to develop the mental health strategy. And what that means in practice is that the key part of this, which we think is probably the bit that has been, there's a range of bits, absent up to now, is really the participation of people with lived experience of mental health problems to support the development of the strategy. We know there's an appetite for that. As you know, I personally was working in that environment previous to this post, but also as the Commission's role in relation to engaging in the implementation group and a group with the Mental Welfare Commission and government, really looking at what are the key issues that people with lived experience of mental health problems have identified, care about, and in relation to the rights framework and the right to the highest attainable standard of mental and physical health, what are the issues, where are the gaps that Scotland needs to respond to? So in terms of taking a rights-based approach to developing the mental health strategy, it would incorporate increased and sustained participation of people in that. That the legal framework around the right to health is both understood and is the framework through which we actually look at the mental health provision in the country, and that there are good and strong accountability mechanisms built into the mental health strategy so that people can actually actively feedback and hold the government and our health boards to account for the provision, that people are empowered to actually claim their rights. So that process, and that within that whole process, we're not discriminating against anybody to participate actively to attain the right to the highest attainable standard of mental and physical health. That process I'm describing of a rights-based approach to mental health is a process I would seek to see apply across government policy. It isn't just exclusive to the mental health strategy, but that's the one that we've identified. So we've made that proposition. We're actually meeting the minister either next week or the week after to actively discuss that. That's a piece of work that's absolutely in progress at the moment. There is more I can say about that in terms of detail, but.
Come on to a specific detail about one thing in a moment, but can I just ask you, is that something that you see will be constantly monitored, and will you have the ability to change the strategy if you come across something that's not working properly or is not delivering the outcomes that you would expect? Do you have the ability to moderate or change the strategy?
No, is the simple answer. We certainly have the capacity to understand what's actually happening on the ground. Mm. Principally, we would do that through our collaborations with other organisations. There are many mental health or non-governmental organisations who have got access to that direct lived experience of what's happening on the ground. If the government establishes a strategy which, from our perspective, we would consider not to have a human rights approach at its heart, our role is to highlight that, to identify the gaps, to see how that can be changed, to highlight the issues on the ground for people. And we would do that through a variety of ways, which are part of our overall approach, but we don't have the power to change the strategy, no.
Okay. Can I ask you specifically now about individuals who are subject to detention orders for their own safety? and how you balance that protection that's put in place for their own safety and their human rights to ensure that they fully understand. How can you influence that?
That's quite a detailed and technical question. I'm going to come back at it from a more general perspective initially. In relation to, so we have a broad accountability role in relation to issues of detention. And Kavita, you might want to add to this in a minute. Under the optional protocol on the Convention Against Torture, we are part of a national monitoring forum called the National Preventive Mechanism. And mental health is what, clearly, as people are detained under the Mental Health Act in Scotland and in the UK, that's a UK mechanism. We are part of a monitoring process to both understand how detention is being applied and to monitor the track record. Now, in terms of mental health, the Mental Welfare Commission in Scotland would be the body with the principal mandate to actually investigate and fully report on aspects of detention. They are a member of the National Preventive Mechanism and are part of that forum of indeed 20 organisations across the UK. So we have a role to play in, and the role we play in that forum is bringing those human rights indicators into play. Now, that, clearly there is a discussion, there are practices within the law, the legal framework within the Mental Health Act in Scotland, which allow currently allow decisions to be made in relation to people's detention under a monitored process. So there are protections built into the current Act. However, the Mental Welfare Commission, I know, and we would agree with that, has said that the Act, Mental Welfare Act in Scotland, needs to be reviewed in order to be compliant with the Convention of the Rights of People with Disabilities. We would agree with that perspective. And one of the key issues that we would highlight in relation to that is the emphasis that is given to supported decision making within the processes that are used to detain people. Now, that just doesn't apply to detention, which is the extreme end of the mental health provision, but to decisions right the way through the route of people's care and treatment. So that at the moment we have a system of not supported decision making. We basically give the power for somebody else to make the decision on behalf of people's treatment. We believe that there are processes that could much more strongly be put in place to ensure that instead of decisions being made on people's behalf without them being involved in it, we could much more proactively engage people in processes of decision making to the full degree of the capacity that they actually have. So there's a whole range of issues around detention, who decides, how that decision is taken, and then currently in Scotland, some of the capacity issues around the actual processes of detaining people. We're aware of the lack of shortage of provision of mental health officers, for example, throughout local authorities in Scotland. That's a key issue which we've highlighted. These are issues which we are very alert to. We bring attention to through a range of processes, including through our treaty monitoring processes and through the National Preventive Mechanism that we're part of in the UK.
And will you be involved in the review of the Mental Welfare Act?
If that happens, yes. We would expect to be, certainly we will, yes, whether we're directly involved or whether we submit evidence in relation to it, yes.
You'll be able to feed into it?
Absolutely, okay. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mary. Willie Coffey.
Thank you very much. Good morning. I wonder if you could just kind of give us a flavour of some of the key achievements and successes that your organisation has had, perhaps in the last year, and how you, or the public indeed, look at your organisation and measure value for money and the success that they get from the endeavours that your team put into this whole arena.
So I'm going to hand over to Kavita to talk you through that.
Sure. So I'm going to focus primarily on the year 2015-16, the annual report that you've gotten in front of you, and just draw out a few sort of success impact examples from that. And I'll work across a sort of law, policy, practice frame to give you a sense of the type of work that the Commission engages in. Highlighted in the annual report, you'll see we engaged in the apology law for victims and survivors of historic abuse in that year. And it was a year ago today, in fact, that law was passed. And I think the Commission's role in the whole historic abuse agenda, where we've been working since 2009, was played a key part in that. And we see that as one of our key successes. Stop and search is another area that in the year 2015-16 we were very vocal both to the Parliament, to the government and to the Human Rights Council in Geneva about the use of non-statutory stop and search. And just last week we had the guidance published which will end the practice of non-statutory consensual stop and search where there's no reasonable suspicion of a crime being committed. If passed by members here, that practice will end later this year. So there are two sort of legal sort of discrete successes where the Commission's voice, I think, contributed something to those debates. In relation to policy, you'll see from the annual report, we reached into a really broad range of settings, into delivery settings where policy is really designed and delivered on the ground, from training over 100 officers in Police Scotland in terms of how they embed human rights in their decision-making, working with independent prison monitors, working with the NHS and the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman to look at complaints mechanisms, working with the Mental Welfare Commission staff to look at how they embed human rights in their decision-making. So we worked in a whole range of delivery settings to see how human rights could be put into practice. And then moving into practice and culture, I think in that year there was a bit of a change in the Commission's focus on economic, social and cultural rights, and really looking more concretely at how human rights relate to issues of poverty, the right to an adequate standard of living, right to housing, right to health, etc. And we did a lot of work in that area, and I think that's part of sort of changing the terms of the discussion in Scotland about what human rights are all about, and really seeing that in a more holistic fashion across the whole range of rights, from civil and political to economic, social and cultural. So we held a number of awareness-raising, profile-raising events around that in the year 2015-16, a large innovation forum, a number of Fairer Scotland round tables looking at issues like human rights budgeting, integrating human rights within our national performance framework, aligning that with the Sustainable Development Goals. So there was a focus in that year, I think, particularly, as I say, on economic, social, cultural rights and changing the debate in that way. We also continued on with our housing project, which many of you here are familiar with, looking at the right to adequate housing. So that was another, in terms of practice and culture, a sort of shift of the Commission. And I think it's very difficult for us in terms of quantifying our success to always know what an individual level of impact might look at. But I think if you look across the range of work that you see there, you know, our hope would be really that the impact of that work would be, for example, that a prison officer would have increased confidence that they were acting in a rights-compliant way when using restraint, when using solitary confinement, etc. That an older person would better be able to navigate a complaint system which was human rights-friendly. That a younger person on the streets is less likely to be stop and searched in a way that's unduly intrusive into their rights. That a resident of substandard housing has more confidence to be able to claim their rights, or that a survivor of abuse is able to receive apology and some sort of partial closure for the abuse that they've experienced. So that's the type of success that we look for in the work that we do, and working across that range of issues from law, policy and into practice and into delivery settings.
Wow, that's quite an extensive set of interventions, some of it direct, some of it more about influencing awareness raising and so on. But do you see there might be an opportunity though to engage with people that you engage with to help you assess your own performance and to get some kind of sense of feedback into your own operational plan about what people's own priorities perhaps are and groups' priorities are for the future? If, say, other organisations, particularly in the public sector, do that fairly routinely, they try to assess externally how they're performing. Do you see a role for the organisation in embracing that agenda a bit more in the coming years?
We do. Good question. Absolutely. I think that's, as a commission, it's a key priority for us going forward. We have done that in the past, so the big research piece that was done, Getting It Right, engaged people directly in questions of how they saw their rights were being accessed, well or not well. So it's not that that isn't practice that the Commission uses currently or has used previously, but in terms of having a much stronger role in guiding the Commission's work, I would say that's a key priority for us. There's one significant way that we are planning to do over the coming year, which is really to establish a series of processes across the Commission where we will proactively be engaging with people. We don't want to make an assumption about people's rights, but we will be asking questions about, because there's a job to do. It's another of our priorities, to really help people understand what human rights means and what that means for them in their own context. Now, the rights framework provides plenty of scope for people to look across the different rights and understand how one might impact on them positively or negatively. And that can be quite a complicated process. But to actually then be able to say, well, we think this is a human rights issue and this is how it's affecting me, that can often be, that needs conversation, it needs time, it needs dialogue. And people need to raise people's levels of understanding and awareness. And from our perspective, as we would be asking government and the Parliament, indeed, would be to prioritise those groups who are the most vulnerable, who are encountering, we would be anticipating, and we know, in fact, are encountering a range of challenges in relation to effective realisation of their human rights. That's an absolutely a process that we're increasing, building in going forward, and using to guide our work, and indeed guide our recommendations to government.
Can I just add to that? Because I think in many ways your question strikes to the heart of what the Commission sort of strives to be all about, because the essence of taking a rights-based approach is, of course, putting the individual and their rights and interests at the centre of decision-making and their lived experience. And that's always been core to what we try to live out. So in developing the strategic plan, which you also have before you, we as much as possible within our resource, we tried to reach out across the country and did a number of engagement events with a wide variety of groups to understand the issues that were of importance to them. And if you look back across the history of the Commission, we've always sought to do that and taken a very consensus-building, collaborative approach to understanding both what the issues are, what a rights-based approach is, and the value that it brings and that it adds. And we've done that through Scotland's National Action Plan. We've done that, as Judith said, through the research that we've done. And where the Commission really wants to build on that now is, again, within its resource, as much as possible, bring in and understand the voice of those with lived experience of the issues that we work on. And again, in the year 2015-16, one of the things that we did was establish a reference group of those with direct experience of poverty, both to help inform the action plan and also to help inform the Commission's work. And that's something that we, as Judith said, we want to build on going forward.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. David Tons.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. On page 6 of the report, there's a bold statement. It says, empowering people to realise their rights through promoting greater awareness and respect for human rights. When you read further down the page, there were 3 events held between August and September, engaging with 100 individuals or organisations. Do you think that's adequate engagements with communities, organisations or individuals across Scotland? And can you maybe expand on what these groups were?
I think I alluded to this potentially in my previous answer. Do I think it's sufficient? The real answer? No. We would love to engage further, to do more, to speak to more people, to address more issues, and I think we have to say that fairly up front. The consultation itself, in relation to our strategic plan, we reached out as far as possible, going from Shetland to the borders, also reaching out through social media and other means. But really, it was a building on the work that the Commission has done that's, as I say, core to the way in which it functions. So we drew on those views, but through all of our work and through the partnerships that we build with a range of organisations and civil society organisations, the Commission is continually responding to and responsive to the issues of people in Scotland. So it's core to the way in which we try to work. That's just part of the process, is where I would situate that.
Can I give you another couple of examples of how that works, so that both to, if it isn't required, reassure you, but also to just expand your that kind of story. Another example would be an example of the Commission, through our legal officer with a responsibility for developing the human rights-based approach, engaged with a number of organisations who were developing a strategy and a process around mental health, around a charter of rights for people with experiencing mental health conditions in Scotland. Now, that process, which the Commission was actively engaged in, supported and developed, reached out into hundreds of people across Scotland, having a conversation, a dialogue about rights, about the right to, as I've said earlier, to the highest attainable standard of physical mental health. So we don't, it's not always the work that we are actively directly doing, but it's the work that we're involving in which is also reaching out. So that's one example, and there are several of those. And the second kind of thing I want to highlight is, to add to what Kavita said, is the communications work that we have done previously to both talk to a range of audiences, to a range of people, to talk about rights, to talk about and to engage people in maybe a less direct discussion about rights. And that, from our perspective, is something we're really seeking to build on and develop in the strategy going forward, in order to meet that kind of principal objective of our mandate to promote and build understanding and awareness of human rights, is really to use as many of the tools and instruments that we have at our disposal to reach into communities and to empower people to claim them. So there's, as well as the direct engagement that we have, there's a range of indirect ways that we do that as well, which from our perspective are very good use of our time and energy.
Right. Thank you.
Alex.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. I should start from the outset by declaring interest that before I was elected, I was a past convener of the Scottish Alliance for Children's Rights Together. I also sat on the leadership panel of the Scottish National Action Plan. We, as a committee, have sought to discharge our human rights remit by looking to the various and numerous concluding observations of the various UN rapporteurs. I wonder if the panel could give us an idea of how the Human Rights Commission works with the various UN committees, the rapporteurs, and to what end, to what extent the concluding observations shape your own work.
Should I start? Okay, certainly. So we, as a national human rights institution, have a responsibility to report to the UN treaty bodies, and we do that across, at the moment, most of the treaties. For various reasons, there are, I think, two of the treaties we haven't reported on, but in the year of the strategic plan, in the year of the annual report, we would have reported on a number of treaties. We consistently do that, and then from that process take forward an analysis of the concluding observations, and are working proactively to work with government to deliver aspects of that. Now, we can talk in some detail about one particular one, which would be the incorporation of economic and social cultural rights, which was something that was reported on from the Committee of Economic Social Cultural Rights, and from our perspective is a real priority going forward in relation to how Scotland can best deliver an effective, you know, human rights protections within the country. It's a key part of our work, reporting to treaty bodies, and it's something that we are going to build on through this plan and going forward. Kavita, do you want to add to that?
Certainly, so Judith touched on the reporting, which is core to our mandate, and last year we reported to the CRC, the Committee on the Rights of the Child, the Human Rights Committee on the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, and the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights. This year we'll be reporting against the Universal Periodic Review process, which is a sort of state peer-to-peer process. And that's the reporting side of it. But I think the question was potentially about the sort of the implementation, if you like, of the recommendations when they come from the treaty bodies and from the Human Rights Council. And that is something that we're looking at much more closely in terms of the follow-up for that. I believe there's been previous discussions even with the committee about, and we would welcome the fact that the committee wants to use them as a vehicle, if you like, to shine a light on some of the key issues that need to be addressed in Scotland. And we would hope that that would permeate the whole of the Scottish Parliament in its particular role as a human rights guarantor, because they certainly do provide a focus of attention where those recommendations have come about as part of a fairly systematic process of feeding in from the state, civil society, and us as the national human rights institution. The concluding observations of the treaty bodies permeate all of our work. We certainly draw on them in all of our work in relation to law and policy, and we consider them carefully in relation to our other strategic priority setting. But what we do want to do going forward is to really ensure that we're doing that systematically and ensure that other actors are also drawing on them, are aware of them, are using them in their own lobbying work and using them in their own priority and agenda setting, and that's certainly something that the Commission wants to, you know, increasingly focus on going forward, and we're pleased the committee is doing so also.
That's very helpful. I think I probably speak for the rest of the committee when I say that, you know, considering when we had the first discussion about using concluding observations as a weather vane as to where we should direct the work of this committee, to then discover that there's something like 900 concluding observations across the various UN treaties, it's something like drinking from a fire hose to a certain degree. I mean, I have my own particular hobby horses, obviously coming from the children's sector around the incorporation of the UNCRC, equal protection from assault for children being one, but I know that other committee members have other particular favourites and focuses. How do you as a commission kind of triage, you know, what's achievable, the low-hanging fruit, what we could do tomorrow to make good on those commitments, and what's that a little bit harder?
Okay. You've actually hit on the crux, if you like, of where we see the Scotland's National Action Plan playing a role, because part of the thinking behind Scotland's National Action Plan, it was drawing on best practice of national action plans around the world. National action plans for human rights have been promoted by the UN since the early 90s. A number of countries across the world have national action plans. The idea, the key principles of that is that the action plan should be evidence-based, collaborative, participative, and monitored and evaluated, not on challenging things. Now, in that collaboration of priority setting, the Commission saw that a way to do that was that triaging of the concluding observations and treaty body recommendations, the views of civil society and those with lived experience of the issues, and the priorities of government and parliament. And where those met would help to set the agenda for Scotland and where the issues that had most traction were. Now, in practice, that has not been a simple process. We're continually trying to build on that within Scotland's National Action Plan. But that's the vision behind it. And that the Action Plan would provide a forum through which to do that triaging, if you like, and that priority setting. So that was one of the vehicles for us to set the priorities from the huge range of treaty body concluding observations. One other thing to say is there is a huge amount of duplication within the concluding observations, so you can weed some out.
Thank you. I'm sorry, Judith.
No, I just wanted to add. I think it's
Now, from your question, Alex, you will see the nature of our challenge too, in that we also have to make strategic choices across aspects of both issues and processes to see how, as we as a commission, going to marshal the resource we have in order to achieve the best, the most impact, the most value effectively for money, and further advance the cause of human rights in Scotland. Now, from that perspective, that's one of the reasons we are focusing and have chosen to focus on the incorporation of economic, social and cultural rights, because we believe that at a level it sits above the whole range of issues, all very real issues, but it enables us to do a number of things to increase people's understanding of what the rights framework actually gives to them, is for them, because the Human Rights Act, to a certain extent, mostly deals with civil and political rights. Incorporating economic, social, cultural rights in Scotland would, to the degree we can do that within the devolved powers of the government, would enable us to have a much more complete rights framework domestically in Scotland that could be used and accessed by our citizens. More constructively, that also sends a really clear message to public bodies and institutions in Scotland to say the government and our parliament are taking rights very seriously. We're taking the rights of our citizens seriously. I'm not saying you don't do that already, but it sends a very clear and strong message to that end. And from our perspective, there's also there's an opportunity at the moment because there's a willingness in government to have that discussion, to take that make that progressive action. There's a more negative opportunity, you want to say it, because we are actually aspects of the Human Rights Act are under question, and we're coming out of Europe, so there's a need, an increased need to strengthen the rights framework domestically. So from our perspective, it's not that then reduces the need to deal with the other aspects of the concluding odds, but it is a strategic way of saying if we get this right, then that potentially could have an impact on all sorts of other areas, which it's not that's not the silver bullet that will deliver a rights respecting, you know, public life in Scotland, but we do think it's an important component, and it's one of the reasons we're prioritising that in our work going forward.
Thank you, Convener. And if I can just say finally, I think that's incredibly helpful. And I'm sure I speak for the rest of the committee to say that I would like to engage with your commission far more over the coming 5 years, just to help us distill down what the art of the possible, what we should be prioritising, so that you are doing that legwork around triage on the concluding observation, so that we don't have to necessarily, although we will obviously do our own due diligence. But I think we're going to be seeing a lot more of you.
We're very happy to do that. I mean, we do see that as part of our role, and that distillation of the concluding observations, all of, and your willingness to engage in that process, and not just, I would say, actively engage, so not just to be on the receiving end of our wisdom, but actually participate in a dialogue and a discussion about that. I think that's really important. You're clearly key actors in that in relation to Parliament. However, we would also consider that to be the responsibility not just of this committee. The concluding observations have impact right across the committee structure and the responsibilities of the government and Parliament in Scotland. And so having those dialogues and conversations across the committee structure would also be very healthy. In fact, an important aspect of the Parliament's responsibilities.
Thank you.
I do agree with your final point there, Judith, and then Mary's question, our immediate thoughts were we need to highlight this to the Health Committee. So part of our role will be ensuring that we highlight anything that comes up at this committee to subject committees in that sense. So we'll continue to do that. Annie?
This is sort of a more specific question, because obviously it's about spotlighting specific issues and holding to account. We have got the bullying strategy from government at the moment, and I think the big thing coming up out of this is human rights sort of aspect of it, of inclusive education for people with disabilities, LGBTI, and about the bullying and how that affects people's human rights at school. And it's just something whether you've looked at that specific issue, or is it something that, because we're obviously going to do a bit of work on it, and we would appreciate sort of an input from you on the sort of human rights side for young people.
I can offer next week essentially talking to some of the umbrella bodies in relation to school bullying. The Scottish Government's delayed the implementation of the bullying strategy following evidence at this committee from a number of young people's groups saying, you know, the strategy needs to be a bit more focused. So the Scottish Government agreed with the committee. So we're taking forward that piece of work starting next week.
Okay. So this raises an issue which I think it's important for the committee to understand and something we grapple with on an ongoing basis, which is that of the key in our legislation is non-duplication. And so as primarily bullying is not just an issue in schools, I'm fully aware of that. And as it reaches into social media, it goes much wider than that. I'm very aware of that. But at the moment, we would consider that to be the principal responsibility of the Children's Commission. And so it's not that we wouldn't necessarily be able to contribute a human rights perspective on some of that, but at the moment, as again, we are a small organisation who's seeking to marshal our resource effectively, and we have within our legislation this piece around non-duplication, we wouldn't be seeking to not address that issue. We highlight the issue through some of our concluding observations. We bring it into our analysis and dialogue, but in this instance, in this context, we probably wouldn't contribute because we would expect the Children's Commission to have the responsibility for that. Does that make sense to me?
Yeah,
there's a number of organisations we're going to be speaking to in the course inquiry anyway to really get to the bottom of it and see where we can make some changes. Can I ask you a couple of questions round about your relationship with the Equality and Human Rights Commission and some of the other organisations? You mentioned your relationship with the UN, but maybe just how those interface, you know, where are the, you know, the systemic parts of that that work together or don't work together. Maybe there's aspects where you think could work better. And you mentioned, Judith, earlier in response to Alex, some of the concerns round about withdrawal from the European Union. We heard from the Prime Minister the other day a withdrawal from the single market, the customs union, and justice, which has a huge impact on anybody's ability to get recourse to justice should they go down that route. We've had a potential repeal and replacement of the Human Rights Act with a British Bill of Rights, and now a manifesto commitment for a withdrawal from ECHR in 2020. And I know that's a lot, but these are all some of the maybe organisations that you would interface with and where some of the pitfalls and challenges would be.
So that's a lot in that question, Christina.
That's why I kept it all for the end.
Can I start with some of
We start at the basics about
start at the basics of the relationships of the organisations. Okay, great. I don't want to either assume knowledge or give you information you don't need. But just so that you know, the Equality and Human Rights Commission in Scotland is principally the equalities regulator. Its principal mandate in relation to human rights is in relation to Westminster, the reserve powers. The Scottish Human Rights Commission's principal mandate is dealing with human rights issues in relation to the competence of the Scottish Government and Parliament. That's how the in simple terms, that's how the landscape is carved up. However, as it will become immediately apparent, there's lots of scope for overlap and scope for concern panning through. In simple terms, just to give you two examples, the impact of welfare reform is reserved legislation but has a direct impact on how Scottish Government, Parliament and public authorities in Scotland actually deal with people who are experiencing poverty and having to access benefits. So that's not a simple line. It's not easy to draw those lines. A second one might be issues in relation to asylum seekers and refugees, where the legislation, the immigration legislation, principal aspects of it are reserved. The Scottish, as you know, Scottish Parliament has no competence over it. But what actually happens in Scotland to asylum seekers and refugees, there's lots of implications. So that, at one level, looks simple, but because of issues like that, we collaborate. And so an example, an active example, is a conversation we're having at the moment, a kind of piece of joint working we're doing at the moment around a rights-based, a human rights-based, an equalities and human rights-based approach to developing the new social security powers in Scotland. So we're collaborating with EHRC. They're undertaking a piece of research in relation to comparative examples internationally of equalities and human rights compliant social security provisions, and working to with the we had a meeting just this week, in fact, with civil servants in the Social Security Division to really see how that could be integrated into their plans going forward. So that's a collaborative process. That would be too strong a word, but underpinning that relationship is a memorandum of understanding what we have with EHRC, in recognition that there will be instances when, if they're doing investigations, for example, across the UK on specific issues, aspects of which are devolved to Scotland, then we will give consent for them to undertake that work. So again, a live example of that is a housing inquiry. They're currently about to, I think they've just started, looking at the experience of people with learning disabilities and their access to housing. That will include a Scottish component, and Scotland will be part of that investigation. There, because they're looking at that through equalities and human rights lens, and that's devolved legislation, we have given our consent for them to undertake that work going forward, effectively lending them our mandate. That's entirely within our gift and their gift to have that dynamic. So we meet with them frequently, regularly, and we have ongoing dialogue and conversation over aspects of work going forward. We're having a meeting in a couple of weeks to look at our forward plans this year to see how can we add value to each other's work and see where the synergies are, and not to duplicate. I come back to that point about non-duplication, so that we're not doing something that somebody else is doing, and they're in the same position. They're not doing something that we're already doing. So that's the kind of landscape. We also meet on an annual basis with the cross UK and Ireland commissions. So I had a meeting on Monday, in fact, in Belfast with the Northern Ireland Commission, the Irish Commission for Human Rights, the Equalities Commission in Northern Ireland, Equalities and Human Rights Commission from West Midland, London, and ourselves, really looking at what are the kind of shared agendas that we have as organisations. And you will not be surprised to know, coming directly into the second part of your question, Christina, Brexit, a potential British Bill of Rights, and the talk around withdrawing from the European Convention was high on that agenda. And of those, all those organisations, as you can imagine, and I'm sure you know, it has different implications in the different jurisdictions around the UK. We're very alive to that, and it's a good forum to have those discussions. And in fact, we agreed that collectively we would seek a meeting with the Department of Withdrawing from the EU, the Brexit Department at Westminster, a collective meeting to it was the UK institutions. Ireland felt they couldn't contribute to that conversation. To highlight the real human rights concerns that we collectively have, and so that I'm pleased we're doing that. I think it's important that we do collaborate on this issue, because it's it will have impact right across those UK jurisdictions. So that's just that's a partial answer to your question. If you want just to go further into the Human Rights Act Brexit kind of piece, we can do that, but if that answers your question initially.
With the UK department on Brexit, we would appreciate some feedback.
Certainly.
On that, if that's possible. That would be very, very helpful indeed.
We're not planning to do that, probably. We're looking to do that sort of before the summer, but not immediately.
Okay. No, that would be very helpful indeed. But on one of the specific aspects about withdrawal, I hosted an event yesterday organised by SPICE, or Scottish Parliament Information Centre here, on Brexit and human rights. And one of the speakers on the panel, Dr. David Cabrelli from Edinburgh University, did an excellent presentation on labour laws and workers' rights. and aspects of workers' rights under the Treaty of the Function of European Union, I think it's Article 18, 19, 42, 43 and 153, which are the rights to equal pay, the rights to paternity, maternity leave, some of those rights. Now, these are the things that would come back because the bulk of labour law is reserved to Westminster anyway, and it is Westminster legislation. It is no, there's no influence really on that from EU directives, but many of these other things are EU directives which we have adopted. And he painted quite a gloomy picture on that, given you know past experiences around about employment tribunals and the changes that were made to that and the impact that then had on you know recourse to justice or access to recourse in that sense. So it painted quite a gloomy picture. I suppose my question to you is that are there aspects of the Brexit developments where repatriated powers in that sense, or you know, taking back control, where you would you do some work on that? My concern, I think, is in this great repeal bill, that some of this would be lost in the detail, when actually it's detail that matters every single day to people's lives, especially in their workplace, not to be discriminated against or not paid adequately, equal pay for equal work and stuff like that. So I don't know whether in your collaboration with some of the other organisations, that's something in that type of detail that you would be taking forward, because as I say, my concern would be if it's not, it might be lost.
Okay. There's a lot in there. I'll start with some broad reflections on what Brexit potentially and indeed Human Rights Act and European Convention of Human Rights proposals potentially mean for us. You know, as the committee is well aware, Brexit does pose significant human rights risks, not only through the disapplication of the Charter for Fundamental Rights and the protections that it contains within the scope of EU law, data protection, privacy, fair trial, bioethics, a range of areas where the rights in the Charter go beyond that of the European Convention on Human Rights, but also, as you say, in the broad spectrum of EU law, particularly in the area of equality protections, workforce protections, consumer rights, environmental protections, coming from the EU in the form of directives, regulations, and decisions from the court. And also sitting alongside this, of course, there's this ongoing threat to protections given by the Human Rights Act and potentially mooted withdrawal from the European Convention of Human Rights, which is, of course, most deeply concerning. Now, clearly, it's very difficult to predict at this point exactly what a future human rights landscape will look like. It will be largely dependent on you know, the relationship that we have, the UK to the EU, on what further devolution might look like, and on what changes we have to our human rights to our human rights laws. And it is very difficult to predict that at this point in time. The sort of strategy of the Commission current in very broad terms in dealing with that, there's two things. Well, one clearly is that we have to be proactive around looking at, well, what are the strongest rights protections that we can have in Scotland? What do they look like in this future and changing landscape? And part of that, of course, we'll be looking at the full range of rights from civil and political to the economic, social and cultural. Now, clearly, two of the areas which are, we, as you've identified, are potentially most at risk and under threat through Brexit are employment and employment protections and equality protections, which are currently reserved. But as this unfolds, we need to look at what the strongest protections, the strongest backstop, if you like, of human rights protections that we can have in Scotland. So one is to be proactive around the laws, and part of that is around a greater and deeper public understanding of both what the risks are posed by Brexit and ECHR withdrawal and what the opportunity is. And you know, it's a relatively technical conversation, but that conversation needs to happen across more broadly across Scotland. So, for example, we're looking next month to hold a public event looking at Brexit. What are the risks? What are the responsibilities? What are the opportunities? And having a more public discussion about that. And then it really is around, well, you know, the terms of the debate. I think, you know, collectively we need to look at how have we come to a place where there's fertile territory for this type of regression to take place? And what part do we all play in changing the terms of that debate? So in very broad terms, you know, that's two things that the Commission wants to look at in that regard.
I think in direct answer to your question around labour laws and our employment rights, I mean, principally that is the remit for the Equality and Human Rights Commission and also other institutions, well, in relation to Equalities, and then in relation to labour, that in a sense is much less clear because the trade unions, for example, would have a significant role to play. We're having a meeting with the Jimmy Reid Foundation, that public meeting that Kavita referred to really could begin to explore some of this in a more public forum. I think I'm not surprised that the predictions were gloomy in relation to the conversation you were having, and that aspect of holding government to account, Westminster government to account. I think the Great Repeal Bill will do something. It's basically saying, you know, at the moment, its principle seems to be that it won't imply regression on the first day. Except what happens after that, I think, when those responsibilities sit wholly within the competence of the UK government, that we need to be very alert and aware of that. Now, the Commission's role in that, we are mandated to focus primarily on the competence of the Scottish Government and Parliament, as any powers that are repatriated from the EU to Scotland, that would become within our competence. But we are also enabled to, you know, make comment and highlight issues from Westminster where they are causing concerns in relation to human rights, and we will continue to do that. But I think it is through those collaborations with other partners that we'll be able to ensure that we're keeping the human rights dimensions alive within those conversations, as well as the specific issues in relation to equalities and work and labour rights. I mean, and environmental protections and all the other potential dynamics that have knock-on effects of our coming out of the EU. I mean, there has been a reasonable amount of work done on that. The Standing Council that is supporting the First Minister has commissioned papers across a range of pieces. We can share that with you if you haven't already seen them. And that's they're really good kind of summaries almost of what some of the issues that are at stake. It goes beyond labour inequalities, but into a whole range of other areas.
Yeah, it's a very movable feast, yeah. Isn't it? Very movable. Your last couple of comments actually feed really well into my final question, I think, for you today. And it was whether you have used your power to conduct inquiries or intervene. And if you haven't, why not? And whether, you know, you see in that future landscape, that movable feast of a landscape, opportunities to do so.
In the simplest form, to some degree, the reason we've not used our legal powers of inquiry and intervention are largely because, and this is my subjective reading of it, I should say, there's been no real need to. Our reading of our legislation and looking back at the debates at the time when our legislation was passed was really that our primary duty under Section 2 of the Act is to promote awareness, understanding and respect for human rights. And our legal powers sit kind of underneath that. And the Commission very much values those powers as giving it the teeth that it needs to do its work properly, and has always had an open door to using those powers. In the early days of the Commission, the focus, as I think I said before, was very much on understanding what a human rights-based approach was and what value it would add, and reaching into different settings, particularly within health and social care, to understand what that meant, and how you implement rights in practice. And part of that strategy was a sort of counter-narrative, if you like, to the more regressive, shall I say, debate that was emanating from Westminster around the Human Rights Act and its future position within the UK. What we see to a certain extent now is while these doors have always been open to us, when we have identified an issue and gone to the relevant public body to talk to them about an issue, there's been a willingness to engage in a human rights discussion, to understand how they can embed human rights in their policy development and delivery of services, which has been very welcome. And as I say, that's what's fed this approach. But there's always a concern that we see a degree of superficiality or complacency to that. So, you know, we do see human rights inserted in the top line of strategies or proposals being mooted as being human rights-based. When you dig under the surface and you see whether the core principles of human rights-based approach, particularly the participation of those who are experiencing issues and the link to the legal framework and the rights that that contains, it's simply not there. And that is something that the Commission has to counter. And I think, you know, that does mean that going forward, the Commission does want to take an approach which complements that by really shining a light on the issues and on what the lived experience of those issues are. So, for example, in our housing project, to actually, you know, go to the houses of people who are experiencing substandard conditions, see what that looks like, feel what that looks like in reality, and then go to the duty bearer and say, this is why you have to implement a human rights-based approach, and this is what it means in practice. So I think there is an interest in using those powers of inquiry to shine a light on areas of concern as a complementary power, if you like, to our general duty to promote awareness, understanding and respect for human rights.
You mentioned a public event, I think, next month. Where is that taking place, and are you planning to webcast it or something, or film it and put it on your website so that a wider audience can either participate or see it?
So I'm hoping that we'll be able to confirm the date and the venue in the next week or so. It'll be a Glasgow-based event, hopefully towards mid-February. We're still confirming the venue, as I say, with the Jimmy Reid Foundation, and we'll think of ways that we can make that as public as possible, because that's what was clear to us in discussions with... They're quite technical issues. The risks are quite complicated to digest, but there's a real need for that public understanding of exactly what's at stake here. So we will be looking to, you know, publicly message that as far as we can.
Thanks very much, Billy. A couple other quick questions. Because your organisation works slightly different for the Children's Commissioner, but it's one commissioner. You've got a commissioner and some, I think, three part-time members, and how you see that working as opposed to a single commissioner. And the other wee aspect, I touched on it at the very, very start, was about resourcing, and I know that you have spoken about resourcing in your strategic plan, and whether you think that's sufficient to do the work that you feel you need to do.
So I will start with the question of resourcing. At the moment, the Commission is in a position where the budget, like many other public authorities over the last few years, has been reduced. We're fairly clear in terms of the delivery of our strategic plan and our operational plan that we will do that within the budget that we have. But the budget is small. We have a big mandate, and we absolutely have to make sometimes on a daily basis strategic choices, hard choices about what we can and cannot do because of the size and scale of the organisation. So, as you would probably hear from any organisation, we will always do more with more. That's absolutely the case. There are a number of areas where I would
there's things we can do within the Commission where I would potentially use the resource differently. Some of that can happen within our budget parameters. But one of the things that would help and assist that is a flexibility in relation to staffing and the balance of staff costs in relation to non-fixed costs, and ensuring that we have that flexibility, which is primarily an SPCB responsibility, to marshal our resources best we can within the constraints that we have. We haven't made a specific request for more money yet. But it's something that we keep under review, and absolutely, if the opportunity was there to do that, we would be able to ensure that that money was spent furthering the absolutely delivering on the mandate of the organisation. The one point I would make explicitly, and this is again very relevant, is that the increased devolution of powers to the Scottish Government increases the scope and the mandate of the Commission. And there has been no explicit acknowledgement of that through a recognition within the budget that we're dealing with a wider range of issues. Indeed, the development of the new social security powers, for example, is a significant, and new taxation powers are two key planks of human rights delivery potentially within Scotland. At the moment, we are responding to those, but we have had no increased capacity to effectively take that into account. You will, if you've scanned your concluding observations, you will see that your 900 of them, or however many there are, you will see that it has indeed been highlighted. And in fact, in our letter of accreditation from the UN in relation to our A status, it's clear that any further devolution of powers would require looking at our resource base to say we need to take that into account. We would welcome that should that be on the agenda. That's my kind of fundamental, I suppose, answer to the resource question. And we may come back to the committee with a more proactive conversation about that in the coming months and years ahead. In relation to the commission structure, I'll be very honest with you. It isn't like anything else. It is a unique structure. My limited experience of national human rights institutions around the world is that they are all unique structures, and they're all uniquely unique, if that makes sense. So there isn't a model, a single model, which is the best model. All of them, I think, have their challenges, whether that be a single commissioner with a, you know, operating as that, or a kind of hybrid structure like ours, where we have a small number of commissioners supporting a full-time chair. It's not without its challenges, because the dynamics of the individuals, but at any level, but the relationship between the strategic and the operational is something that we have to manage effectively. And at the moment, the commissioners' times are 2.5 days a month. Which is why they're not here today, because they're busy people. They have other commitments, and it's not that this isn't a priority. But coming to the end of a financial year, they really do well more than their hours in terms of a kind of support for the process, and in order for us to ensure that we talk as a commission, rather than simply the chair of the commission, we have to engage them in the policy conversations that we're having on a day-to-day basis, but on a frequent basis, and that in itself is time-consuming and requires them to engage proactively in the discussions we're having. So we're careful about that. I'm always minded of that it's not me speaking; it's a commission speaking; it's a group of people, and that in itself is a resource. It's a draw on resources. It's how it is at the moment, and I think we're managing that reasonably well. And I think commissioners are both engaged, in the process of the commission, and they support our work proactively. And they bring different skills and competence to the commission. But and we haven't had this conversation directly with commissioners prior to here. But I'm very open to truly looking at that. But there is real value in it, and it brings challenges as well. So there's, you know, there's pros and cons.
like any organisation.
Yeah, absolutely.
Is there any other questions from colleagues? No, I think we've exhausted with questions for you today, although probably absolutely not exhausted our relationship with you. As you understand, a lot of the work programme that we have decided to take on will ensure that we have constant and ongoing engagement with you, and we look forward to that. Can we thank you for your evidence this morning, thank you for your report, and thank you for the ongoing work that we will continue to do on behalf of the committee. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you.
So that concludes our evidence in public today, and I'll suspend committee and move into private.